Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the last lecture, we introduced functions which process an input variable, which we will call x, to produce an output value. If we call the function f, then the output value it produces is called f of x. In algebra, these input and output values are typically real numbers. In this case, we say that f is a real-valued function of a real variable. We saw that the input variable x is called the independent variable, since its value does not depend on any other variable. The independent variable can take on any input value which the function is capable of processing. The set of all valid input values is called the domain of the function. And the set of output values which the function produces from x is called the range of the function. If we assign the output value to the variable y, we say that y is the dependent variable, since its value depends on the value of the independent variable x. We can think of the function as mapping values in its domain to values in its range. Although it is possible for a function to map more than one domain value to the same range value, a function can never map a domain value to multiple range values. The domain and range of real-valued functions of a real variable often consist of an infinite number of values. Since we can't list every value, we represent them using the variables x and y, and visually represent the infinite set of ordered pairs of the function's graph using the Cartesian plane. This graph visually shows how each domain value, corresponding to a point on the x-axis, maps to a specific range value, corresponding to a point on the y-axis. Since each domain value must map to exactly one range value, this limits the shape of the function's graph in certain ways. For instance, this graph represents a function, since each value of x maps to a single value of y. However, this graph does not represent a function, since there are some values of x which map to two different values of y. Likewise, this graph does not represent a function, since once again there are values of x which map to more than one value of y. However, if we rotate this graph by 90 degrees, then it can represent a function, since any value we pick on the x-axis will map to only one value of y. There are an infinite variety of real-valued functions of a real variable, and the graphs of these functions can have any imaginable shape, as long as each value in the domain maps to only a single value in the range. An easy way to test for this condition is the vertical line test. Since each x value in a function's domain must map to no more than one y value in its range, a vertical line drawn at any position on the x-axis must intersect the graph at no more than one point. To use the vertical line test, take a ruler and move it from one end of the x-axis to the other while keeping it parallel to the y-axis. If the ruler intersects the graph more than once for any value of x, the graph does not represent a function. On the other hand, if the ruler never intersects the graph more than once for any value of x, it does represent a function. So this curve represents a function. However, the same curve rotated by 90 degrees fails the vertical line test. Therefore, it does not represent a function. Any linear graph represents a function, unless the line is vertical. This curve fails the vertical line test and therefore does not represent a function. Curves like this, which are not functions, are still binary relations, since binary relations can have any number of y values associated with any given value of x. However, If we eliminate parts of the relation which cause it to fail the test, then its graph can represent a function. Likewise, this curve does not represent a function, but this curve does. So far, we have seen functions which process a single input variable to produce a single output value. In the next lecture, we will introduce functions which process multiple input variables from which they produce a single output value.